So this network is related to EPFL, and this is about the researchers and the publication at EPFL.
This is Kirell Benzi, a data science researcher who recently graduated with a PhD from EPFL. In a previous video, we discussed Kirell's most celebrated artwork, namely a depiction of the social network of the Star Wars expanded universe. In this video, Kirell will tell us about three other data science artworks that he made.
So each node here will represent like a researcher, could be a professor, postdoc, or a student, a PhD student, and they are connected if they have been co-publishing a paper together. So it's interesting to see that, so you have different colors, and here the colors are representing the communities in the network. And as you would expect, people are more, they're more connected in their community because they belong in the same lab or the same research domain. So for instance, here you would have the signal processing part of the graph, and I'm somewhere here. My professor is here. And it's really interesting to see the different labs.
In particular, Kirell's artwork allows to quickly identify the way research at EPFL is structured.
Okay, this big cluster of nodes is the plasma center. So, okay, why are they more connected? I think it's because the experiments need a lot of people, because there are real experiments to conduct, so that's why they are more connected together.
But you might be able to go beyond analysis and make actual predictions based on Kirell's data visualization.
One fun fact about this is that the most central point of the network, meaning the point where all the path leads to, like all the path leads to Rome, but here's all the path leads to Martin Vetterli, which is actually the president of EPFL. It's really funny because you could say, now, yes, the president of EPFL has been elected by, you know, because it connects most of the people of the network. And it's really, in this case, it is true. So it's really, it's a nice fact and fun fact.
So you could have predicted the future.
Exactly. I could have said, no, yes, Martin Vetterli is going to be elected. And I can tell you the second one on the list, but maybe I should not disclose this.
I guess we're joking here, but you can imagine that you could make some seriously valuable predictions based on such data.
This one is another, as you see, it's different from the previous one. It's another network visualization about the Montreux Jazz. So if you're not familiar with the Montreux Jazz, it's one of the most famous music festival in the world. And it has been going on for more than 50 years now. And the idea here is just to connect, so artists, each node is an artist, could be a singer, but also a musician. And they are connected if they have been playing together in the same concert over time. So this is over 50 years of data.
And just like before, Kirell's artwork unveils aspects of the Montreux Jazz.
There's one interesting phenomenon here is you have really two types of communities. The ones that are really at the border of the string, they are completely disconnected and they are really small. So imagine that each community is actually a band and they are connected if they have been playing together. Now, why are there different types of community? You see, you have the border, and in the center, it's densely packed and more crowded. Well, it's because, and mostly because of the program. So the genre, the musical genre, and how the guys in charge of the you know, setup and of the Montreux Jazz chose the artist.
So how does the genre of music affect the collaboration between the musicians?
What you would have in the center is the, let's say, all the jazzmen and bluesmen. So for instance, here you would have all the community around George Duke. Here would be around Santana, and the yellow one about B.B. King. And they're really like the festival all-stars. They came every year at the festival for like 30 years. So they're really connected. And
but why would blues and jazz favor on-stage collaborative performances?
Because they play blues and jazz, they invite a lot of people to jam. So some of them you have never heard of, but because of the music genre, that's why they are more densely connected.
That's a cool fact. But wait, didn't Michael Jackson perform at the Montreux Jazz at some point?
I think Michael Jackson is somewhere here in with this band, but he actually never mixed with others. Maybe he came only once. So none of their his musician actually came another year. So they are really not connected to the rest of the bands.
Information content aside, I very much like the visual aspect of this graph. It feels structured and ordered.
It's funny because some people told me, oh, it looks like a Petri dish, you know? And some other people told me, oh, no, it looks like an iris. It's like an eye. It's... And what's cool thing about this is like, is on this data art, you see what you want to see. But as soon as you read the description, then it, like 50% of the work makes sense.
Awesome. Let's move on to QL's third artwork.
Notice it's a bit special compared to the other because this one is printed on brushed aluminium. So depending on where you stand, you would see a different shade in the colors, depending on the light. And this one represents a network, of course. It represents the tweets around the Higgs boson discovery. So if you remember, like 5 years ago, the CERN scientists discovered the Higgs boson. It was really big in the science community. And this is some part of the tweets that are actually talking about this. And this network is a bit special because it's what we call a spatial-temporal network. So it's easy. The idea is that the connections here are actually made in time. They are following the graph of followers. So if you follow someone on Twitter, you see his news feed on your own timeline. And the idea is here we're going to use this graph and we're going to combine on top of this the activity. So the number of activity could be anything. And here the activity is the number of retweets and the number of mentions in the over time. So once we combine the structure of the followers, so who follows who, plus the activity, we can create what we call the causal multilinear graph of activity. So this one is just a spatial-temporal graph. Our nodes are connected to their neighbor's counterpart in the next time steps.
QL told me offline that the same kind of model was used to understand the neural connections inside our brains. And I find this analogy quite fascinating. Thinking corresponds to signals that are propagating from neurons to neurons inside our brains. The way Twitter works is not so different. Each Twitter user is kind of like a neuron that's sending messages to its followers, and then followers sometimes pick up this message and propagate it to its own followers. Notice that in these networks, the time dimension is quite relevant because it's all about propagation, and Kirell's artwork beautifully captures this time dimension.
How do we encode this visually? Here it's by playing with the colors. So actually the whole phenomenon starts on top with all the blue nodes here. And as you move in time, it starts from blue and you go to green, yellow, orange, and you turn like this to finish to pink. So here the shades of color are actually embedding the time dimension.
Plus, just like before, this beautiful artwork tells many underlying stories.
One interesting fact about this network and the usage of the usefulness of the visualization is that you can see here, you have two bananas, two big communities. And we notice that actually this community represents Europe and this one is the US because it has been discovered in Geneva and the time zone was more about the European time zone. And as we see here, the rumor starts spreading, and this is the official announcement is just in the middle. So here, it's really a lot. Most tweets are actually coming after the announcement. And what you see here on the bottom is that the US are responding, are tweeting to the European researchers, because it's a worldwide event. So it's not specifically related to Switzerland or Europe. And this is something useful that we learned with this visualization. So, of course, okay, it could be aesthetically pleasing, but it's also useful here for the scientific study.
As a designer, you can communicate a lot of information very quickly because we all have brains that are designed to recognize patterns this way.
But here, the usage of this data art is more about generating emotions than doing pure visualization to make decisions.